Welcome to the Center of Light Radio with spiritual teacher, intuitive, musician, composer, and best-selling author of The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, your host, Keith Anthony Blanchard.
Yeah, Keith Anthony Blanchard here, your host of Center of Light Radio, Monday night, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. We had a fantastic show last week. Kenneth Pass, child time travelers, beginning to create a lot of buzz around social media and across the internet. If you want to check out that show, make sure you go to YouTube. You can also go to Inception Radio Network through the archives there. But also, if you like the video format, you can go to YouTube and look up Center of Light Radio's YouTube site. Listen to the interviews there. If you have any particular interviews that really stick out for you, give me a thumbs up. You can always welcome to subscribe. It sure helps out Center of Light Radio. But also, if you leave me a comment in that box, it lets me know what kind of guest you're really looking for in the future. That way I can do my homework and begin to bring those guests to the platform so you can have exactly what it is that you're wanting, so you can expand that particular spiritual muscle of yours into greater degrees of bliss. Center of Light Radio, as I said, welcome, welcome, welcome. Chat room, everyone in the chat room, hello. Always good to see you, Don Danny. MJ's in the house. Woo-hoo. And as well as Dana. The music you hear at the beginning of every Center of Light broadcast, usually two pieces of music, the theme song and one before that, is my spiritual group Lavender Soul, made with members of the Memphis Symphony Orchestra. Phenomenal music. If you want more information about Lavender Soul, you can always find me for any reason whatsoever at keithanthonyblanchard@gmail.com. For those who are a Center of Light Radio, hello Starlight, I see you in the chat room. For those who are Center of Light Radio return people, I guess you can say, fans, fanatics, I love that word, fanatic. You've heard me talk about my alien human hybrid friend, Nucleus 8. Well, I had a pretty powerful experience with Nucleus the other night. I've only seen him once in Sleepscape. But the other night, he was standing right next to me, and I had the opportunity to really step back and take him all in and look at him. And he looks a little more human than I thought. And people are thinking, Keith, you sure you weren't dreaming? Trust me. I've been doing this a long time. This is reality. I've had many experiences when I would come out of sleep only to have because of my phone ringing. And it's him on the phone, and I proceed to tell him what's going on. And he begins to finish my statements about my dreamscape and that which was happening during it. So this is very, very real. And I'm still doing my best to try to get Nucleus 8 on Center of Light Radio. It's probably going to be a pre-recorded show because we do not want his person that he wants, works through to be targeted. So we can't do that. But I will let you know. I sent him a message the other day, and hopefully we'll hear something shortly. Services for those who need my services. I've been doing a lot of speaking engagements. I've done it for years, years, years. Life-changing presentations on spirituality. I'm really big into divine incarnations, avatars, from everyone like Baba G to Satya Sai Baba. And those who are coming, I'll also do presentations on extraterrestrials, my personal experience, as well as some of the other things that I do a lot of research and finding out about this. I'm really big into this new series on Gaia TV called Cosmic Disclosure. In fact, In two weeks from now, I'm going to have one of the guests from Cosmic Disclosures, Heather Sartain. She's going to be on Center of Light Radio. I believe her father worked with NASA, and he told some pretty amazing stuff. But back to my services. I can do presentations and all these things. And if you want me to come to you, I can cater whatever thing to what it is you're needing for such speaking engagements. Also, if you have spiritual squatters in your house, dark entities, ghosts, poltergeist, just some bad people, and you want them gone because there's no peace in your house, contact me at keithanthonyblanchard@gmail.com. I know what it's like. I had some friends of mine in the recent past who has had such issues with dark entities, and it's all a vibrational thing. And one way you need to empower yourself to change the situation is not go external and blame whatever you think is happening in your house. That's the first wrong movement. You need to look at yourself. You need to ask yourself, what is it about me and my situation that I've brought my vibration to this like vibration as to why this is happening? That is the first step to changing the problem in your house if you're having dark entities. But know that I come with an arsenal of information, powerful information, pictures, mantras, anything that I would give to you that would raise the vibration of you in your home, that will change this for you. And I will not hand you the information and split. I'm in it with you all the way until you have peace in your house. I don't foresee it, you know, the need for us to call an exorcist, but you can bet that the information that I have will be very, very powerful. A couple of more quick announcements. I think we have Cate on the line. So give me one moment. We're going to get right back with my phenomenal guest. Also, no word from Swamiji Vispayogi, God realized man from India. Hopefully, we're going to be hearing about him soon. I had a sleepscape experience with him as well. And usually these things that happen to me, I can almost, on the other side when I wake up, kind of intuit what these messages mean. And I think Swamiji is going to be coming back to Memphis sometime soon. So enough with all that yada, yada, yada. It's time to get down to Center of Light Radio business. Today, my guest is Cate Montana. We'll be speaking about ego, enlightenment, and other essentials. Ever lie in bed fantasizing about an easy, more fulfilling life? Join the club. Learn how you can be free to be the real you and create what your authentic self desires. In her book, you'll discover how to experience F, freedom from illusion, R, relief from the burden of your ego story. We were just talking about that, moving through that bullcrap story that incessantly tell you who you are. E, excitement over authentic evolution and change. And E, expansion in all areas of your life. The author of Unearthing Venus, My Search for the Woman Within, and co-author of The Heart of the Matter with Dr. Darren Weissman, Cate Montana has a master's degree in humanistic psychology and writes and teaches about the ego, transpersonal and transcendent consciousness, quantum physics, and evolution. A journalist for almost 30 years, she served as the Northwest Bureau Chief and Editor for the National Native American Paper Indian Country Today, and has written for Seattle Magazine. I love Seattle. I was there for a while. And numerous other Northwest publications, while editor of the Bleeping Herald newsletter for the hit indie film, What the Bleep Do We Know? Oh, very cool. Very cool film. I really dug it. She interviewed physicists, biochemists, and consciousness researchers writing about and demystifying quantum mechanics and consciousness for lay audiences. Currently, she writes for the UK publication What Doctors Don't Tell You and blogs for the Huffington Post. She lives in the Pacific Northwest. You can reach Cate and know more about her at www.cate, that's C-A-T-E, catemontana.com. Cate Montana, welcome to Center of Light Radio. I am worn out.
After all that, I guess you are. Don't you love technology? What it works.
Well, we were playing Skype tennis for a while. We were batting back and forth, and we finally got you here, dear.
Into the net.
Yes. How are you today, girl? Everything wonderful?
Everything is beautiful. We have blue skies here for a change, and that's a rarity in February in the Pacific Northwest.
Are you still in Seattle?
I am in, state capital Olympia, Washington, down at the bottom of the Puget Sound.
I lived in Bellevue for a while. I just absolutely loved it.
Oh, it's a beautiful state. It's gorgeous. I'm so glad I moved here, almost 30 years ago now.
Ego, enlightenment, and other essentials. Give me, an overview of this particular fantastic piece of work of yours.
Oh, okay. I started writing the E word back in December of 2014 because it was the book that I never wanted to write. I never wanted to expose myself, Keith, and reveal what I had experienced and what I knew about the ego structure and what I knew had come to understand about enlightenment. It's such a buzzword, hot topic. Everybody in the spiritual community, you know, talks about enlightenment as if, they talk about enlightenment. And I was just determined I wasn't going to be.
I just caught that. I'm sorry. Please continue.
That's quite all right.
Right.
And anyway, Spirit had other ideas. And finally, after about 8 years of denial, it just became obvious I had to start the book. So I did. And immediately it had a mind of its own. I quickly got a second, another literary agent because of the book. She loved it. She sent it to a new Simon & Schuster publisher at Enliven, and they bought it in like 2 hours. They just went nuts over the book. So wow. It's been kind of a it's been a luge ride downhill on ice. I mean, it's or uphill on ice. It's just been explosive. And because, you know, we've kind of hit the I'm not going to say we're past the halftime and we're at the slow end of the slogging three-quarter mark when the spiritual community, at least that's what it feels like. I know I talk to a lot of people and they feel like they just got lead boots on. They're not going anywhere. It's kind of the same old conversations about, you know, unicorns and and rainbows and the latest book and all of that. And I just kind of came out of the closet, and because I realized in my own personal search, Keith, that was, you know, 25 years and at least 20,000 hours of meditation. And I really leaned in. I wanted to become enlightened. I just was hell-bent and determined that I was going to have truth on my side. I was going to have it in my back pocket. And then, you know, I'm it. And what a shocker after all of that effort. And hell, I spent years alone meditating by myself in a one-room cabin in the middle of the North Georgia mountains, you know, with no indoor plumbing and no running water and no electricity. I went there to meditate, and I did that for 6 years. So
wow,
I was really
serious. You were serious.
Yeah. I was serious about this shit. So wham, one morning, I was so tired of meditating anywhere from 4 to 8, 13 hours a day. I lived my whole life around this. I designed my life so I could stay at home and write and be a journalist so I could do my meditations. And I hit the wall one morning around the year 2000. And I just looked at my meditation pillow one morning, Keith, and I said, screw it. That's not what I said, but that's what I said. And I just flopped down on my pillow and gave up. I didn't do a breathing exercise. I didn't do a chant. I didn't do a mantra. I didn't light incense. I just closed my eyes and gave up. And it was like, I was gone. Cate Montana was gone. And when Cate Montana opened her eyes and I was back, the Cate Montana show was back in the driver's seat. It was, what a cosmic joke. It was like, oh. Non-dual awareness means non-dual awareness. It means there's nobody home to be aware of being aware. There's no Cate being enlightened. There's no Cate going, oh, wow, non-dual reality, cool. There's no Cate. There is no persona. There's no self left to experience liberation. And what a bummer for the ego. Because, you know, there went all of my hotshot ideas about becoming enlightened and then, you know, strutting my stuff on the stage in white robes, becoming a spiritual teacher.
I can relate to that completely.
Oh, it was shattering, but it was also the biggest cosmic joke in the freaking world. And it was like, oh, I get it. And of course, after that, I spent the next, probably easily the next year in really strident meditation, trying to get back to that place that there was no me. And of course, that never happened again until, again, I surrendered, even the need to surrender. And after that, I spent years going in and out of non-dual reality, non-dual awareness. And then, you know, I'd pick up my, open my eyes. And
when you describe non-dual, it's common sense that you're implying that in these shifts that you were reaching states of non-duality, but meaning you were actually integrating aspects of your higher self. Is that what you mean? And you staying there for a while?
No, I was not integrating aspects of my higher self, because ultimately there is no such thing as a higher self. The lower self is an illusion. Therefore, the higher self is as well. So there was no me integrating anything. There was just life, existence, awareness of I am.
Yeah, that would be my higher self in quotes, a way to describe.
That's a way to describe it.
Yes. See, that's why those who listen to my show, I'm always quoting everything. I actually use my fingers in the air when I do it, because some people take it so literally. But yes, I do understand your point. And now I understand the non-duality awareness.
Yeah. I mean, the language, Keith, is so touchy. It's so critical. And we get
and somewhat to some degree, it can be very, very important, because it does describe the mindset, the heart set that the person is operating from.
It does. And we we get used to the language. You know, we talk about the higher self and the lower self, but and it's a convenience, and it's the way we have to. It's a natural way to talk when you're in the dream, when you're in the illusion of the personal self. There's really no other way to wrap your head around it. It's only until you get out of the dream that you realize that languaging such as, well, the higher self and my lower self is really duplicitous, because it sets us on a wild goose chase. It sets up, it concretizes the reality of the ego, the lower self. And the lower self, the ego, absolutely is an illusion. So it's you know, boy, it's like walking the plank, Keith. This very, it's a narrow edge we walk. And, you know, on one hand, we have to language it so we can talk about what we can't talk about. And then on the other hand, that's why experience is so that's why experience is so vital. That's why I wrote why I wrote the book and why Spirit pressed me to write the book is it's about gaining the experience of those non-dual states, of those integrated, connected states that take us outside of our, for lack of a better way of putting it, lower self, our personality. And that's what the book is about. It's about helping people make those shifts.
So I guess when we walk that razor's edge, mm-hmm. that's why we often cut our feet, because we constantly teeter-totter between the light and the dark and through some of the grays, and that's really not the truth of it at all. We are here and we're here now, and it's all that there is, and everything else is the illusion, because, you know, like you said, some of the dialect we use can describe a person's mindset, heart set, or just natural disposition, but often we get caught up in all those words.
Of course. Your language is the way we communicate, and language is the communication method of the separate self. And there's nothing wrong with the ego. The ego's kind of got a bad
I love
rap
mine.
Nowadays.
We have fun together. We have fun.
The ego is inevitable. It is a state of mind. It is a perspective that our bodies give us. The moment we get spit out of the birth canal, Keith, the body gives us two inescapable messages. The first one is, oh my God, I'm physical. Oh my God. There's 11 million bits of sensory data a second come into our brain every second, telling us through our eyes, ears, nose, our skin, I am physical. Oh my God. And then the second message that mostly our eyes, but the rest of our senses also give us is, I am separate. Even as an unconscious pre-verbal infant, we lie there in the crib and we want the breast or the bottle. We want milk. We want sustenance. We're hungry. And it's outside of us. Now, there's no language. There's no word in our head to go, oh, the bottle, the breast, it's outside of me. I need it. Give it to me now. But we unconsciously start to manipulate what we perceive as the exterior world to get what we want. And then fast forward 40 years and this constant, inescapable message of I am physical, I am separate, gives us the ego persona. The moment we start having language, the moment the baby in the crib begins to associate, you know, the name Keith. Oh, Keith! Oh, Keith! You know, your little baby brain at some point went click. Oh, now there's no words in your baby brain at this point, but if there were words, your baby brain would have gone something like, oh, I wonder if Keith, that sound is associated with this weird sense I have about being like on my own and got the skin boundary and I'm separate from mommy and daddy. I wonder if that sound, Keith, is that sense of separate self. So then we have a label. And then that's the very start of the crystallization of the ego persona. From there, you begin to have language, you have pronouns, you do I and me and you and them and us and them. And we learn through language that separation is a reality. And our eyes and our ears and our nose and our skin and our tongue consistently give us this message. And then we go to school and we learn we're black and white and we're Jewish and we're Christian and we're Hindu and we're Muslim and we're this and that. And, you know, by the time we're 7 years old, we have a hugely solidified sense of personal individual self, which is great, because if we didn't have it, if we couldn't differentiate ourselves from the rest of the quantum soup, this of consciousness that comprises everything, you know, I wouldn't be able to tell the difference between myself and my dog, or myself and the wall, or myself and the bus coming at me at 45 miles an hour down the road, you know? If I was just tuned into the quantum sea of isness, there's no differentiation at that level.
Well, we left that to come here.
Yes, we left that and we're here.
Also something you were talking about. You were talking about the separation process when the ego is born and how it gets reinforced. If you think about it, at a young age, children play with those things on the coffee table that came from grandma that are made of porcelain and crystal and all these cool things because they think it belongs to them, because it does belong to them. And then when the parent steps in and says no, we automatically reinforce that disconnection, that separation, that this is you and that's grandma's and you shouldn't be touching it.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. The list goes on and the list goes on.
They feel bad for doing so because you scolded them and that, oh, my God, don't touch that.
Yeah. When the natural thing is just to relax into life and play and just be very, very present. But it's the language game that really starts to give us this sense of personal identity that becomes our personal story. And then we get locked into the story and then we can't change. And then what happens is kind of like, I don't know about you, but I hit the wall at age 30 when I realized that.
Did it hurt?
Yeah, it hurt. It hurt really bad because, you know, I'd spent the first 30 years of my life doing everything that society and my mommy and daddy and my teachers and the nuns told me to do to be a happy person. And I hit, you know, and at 30, I was like, oh, my God, I've done everything right. I got a college degree. I got a good education. I have a great career in network television. I've got a fabulous husband, a house with a swimming pool. I'm not happy. So, you know, we hit the end of that rope, but there's nothing in our reality except maybe church that uses words like spirit and soul to go that there's something more. So, wow, what a journey we're on, Keith.
I mean, oh, I love it. I love love. I wake up every morning. Cate, I wake up every morning. I cannot, as soon as I feel myself being pulled from sleepscape into the room, I can't get into the room fast enough from waking because I'm ready to start my day, sit at my computer, see who made contact with me, see what kind of project I can invent today. I'm so enjoying this ride. Today, my guest is Cate Montana, and we're speaking about ego, enlightenment, and other essentials. Keith Anthony Blanchard here at Center of Light Radio to remind you about my lifelong work, RPM, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. Let me ask you a few questions. What is it you want out of your life? You want more financial stability? You want relationship? You want greater degrees of bliss, conscious expansion, and spiritual evolvement? These are magnificent, wonderful things, and I have achieved all of these by implementing what I am offering to you so you can apply this to your life so you can have all those things that you truly desire and truly deserve. I absolutely guarantee my work 100%. Go to Center of Light Radio, look at the opening page, the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. Not only will you receive my awesome Power Pack newsletter monthly, but you will have access to my RPM program. Stay in touch with me, and I will send you everything I'm about, all my successful works. You can bet. All you have to do is contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Peace, love, and light to you always. From the chat room, Cate, we have a question from Don Danny. He asked the question, doesn't consciousness require individuality or awareness of the separate self?
Well, it depends on what you mean by consciousness. If you follow what's like Sir Roger Penrose has postulated, the English mathematician and physicist, that consciousness is the bedrock of all reality. It is all of reality, that consciousness is everything. So everything is one thing, and yet we have this multiplicity in unity, this dream state, this illusion that shows up as multiplicity in oneness, and it's all fabricated out of the same thing. And we can use words like quantum sea, or we can use words like intelligence, or we can use words like consciousness, which kind of begs the question, well, what are we really talking about? You know, we think we know what we're talking about because we can label it with a word. Oh, it's consciousness. But what does that really mean? So it's you know, one of the best ways.
Let me ask you this, Cate. I don't mean to interrupt, but wouldn't a definition of consciousness be aware of the fact that you exist? That would be consciousness.
That would be one form of consciousness. That's self-aware consciousness. Okay. That's right. Self-aware consciousness. But if everything is made of consciousness, intangible intelligence, okay, let's just call it intangible intelligence.
I like it.
Then the granite rock sitting outside my front door, does it have consciousness? I would say yes. Is Absolutely. It self-aware? I don't know. At what level is it self-aware? I do not know. It might be. It might be absolutely aware of its rockness. I don't know. but here it gets tricky, because when we talk about individuality, one of the best ways to explain this is imagine a blanket, okay, a black blanket. And if you stick your finger up underneath the blanket and form a peak in the blanket, that's you. And if you take your other finger on your other hand and you stick up, you know, a finger up through that blanket, now you get two peaks in the blanket, right? And it's all connected by the blanket. And that's you and that's me. And then there's Don on the other end of the radio, had little peaks in all of this blanket. You know, it's all of creation. There's the moon and Saturn and the sun and a spaceship, Eiffel Tower, you know, a ham sandwich. But it's all the blanket.
Yeah, we connect. We're all connected
peaks.
By the
invisible. Can you imagine that?
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely.
It's the same thing. We are the same thing. That's what then we appear. We show up. These peaks show up in this fabric of isness, this fabric of consciousness, this fabric of intelligence that appear to be distinct, multiple, and individual, but are absolutely not. That's the illusion.
Yeah, we're all part of the same shattered mirror. I mean, it's all reflective. Kate, we talked a bit about ego and enlightenment. What are the other essentials?
Yeah, Will Arntz of What the Bleep asked me that too. Expansion is one. One of the things that I've really, really learned is if enlightenment doesn't bring personal liberation, which it does not, because there's no one present, no personal presence left to go, wow, I am enlightened. An enlightened person would never say that, because it's absolutely a false statement. There is no I at that point. There just is. So, and I totally lost my train of thought. Doggone it. Keith, can you poke me here?
Ego. You said there was, when you get to that state of consciousness or that state of realization, there is no more I. It's all melts into the ism.
It does. It does. So there has to be a different way. Thank you. It has to be a different way that I can be liberated. So the only way I, Cate Montana, or you, Keith, can be liberated from the tyranny of the illusion of separation that the ego gives us is to start retraining the brain to move into something that is called, psychologists term it, transpersonal consciousness. And I got so excited when I realized that this is the middle ground. This is really what most people are looking for, most on the spiritual path. You know, we're looking for fulfillment, connection, liberation from the tyranny of our fears and vulnerability. That would be
the story.
That is for, yeah, exactly.
You know what, Kate? I will tell you this. And for, like you, for many, many years, I read all the books. I read all the Wayne Dyer books. I read Carolyn Mace. I did Dan Millman. I did all the books. I did all the Deepak Chopra CDs, all that, just like everybody else. And I meditated for hours upon thousands of hours. I've done all that. And all that is wonderful stuff. And it did help to get me to this place where I'm at now in my life.
Yeah.
I would say about 4 or 5 years ago, I decided to, quote, take all that and throw that in the metaphorical spiritual trash, because it's still part of the story. And I realized that if a person wants liberation, meditation is a great catalyst. But if you really want liberation, you have to move. You have to learn how to move through the story that is constantly bickering in your mind. Mm-hmm. You know, we might be sure that the devil on one shoulder is devilish, you know, but are we not so, are we sure that the angel on the other shoulder is not the same devil in disguise? And it's that kind of noise, when you can silence that noise, when you get out of the fight, the mm-hmm. fight with the world, the fight with your friends, the fight with the colleagues, the fight with the terrorism, the internal fight, when you get out of all that stuff, there is a third component between that, like you mentioned. There's mm-hmm. something that happens. The Phoenix, the Christ.
Yep. Or I am.
Correct. And it's yep. learning and how to move through the dialogue. When a friend of mine years ago, my mentor, he strongly suggested, he said, Keith, put notes all around your house where you see them often that says, get out of the story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Saul's story. As you say, the angel on your shoulder is a story. The devil on your shoulder is a story. Your own name is a story. Yes. It's all story. And it's so easy to get lost down that rabbit hole. And the spiritual story is just more story. You know, when I became spiritual, after, as I say, when I hit the wall at 30, I was like, well, the material world isn't doing its thing for me and I'm not happy. What else is there? And then the only place to look was within. So then starts the spiritual path where you're all, you know, you're wolfing down Wayne Dyer and Tony Robbins and Carolyn Meese and all that, like you said. And then you're a spiritual person.
Oh, yeah.
And you now you really, you know, Keith, God, if you'd asked me 10 years ago anything, I could have told you anything about creation, about, you know, anything you would have wanted to know, I could have told you, because I knew everything back then as a spiritual person. I had a lot of stories that I had inherited from other people in books and thought that that meant something.
So
and,
how
and what it meant was that I was just lost in more story.
So how would you suggest someone begin to move through that story? Because here in Center of Light Radio, I'm really big about when my guests come on the platform, they always offer a nugget that the listening audience could begin to implement in their life and begin to see change that as to why they come to the show repeatedly hoping to get.
Absolutely. First of all, we have to know what the ego, where the story comes from. And to do that, we have got to finally understand what the ego actually is. You know, again, there's a tendency, because I can say the word ego, and I've read a little bit of Sigmund Freud, that I think I know what I'm talking about. But we really don't. We have more story. So the, you know, and I'm not going to say my book is the definitive answer to anything, but it's pretty freaking clear about what I've come to understand and what drives it and what keeps it in the driver's seat, pumping out the story. So the first thing we've got to do is understand what the ego is. And I highly cannot say strongly enough, take at least an hour a day to go within. Be serious about it. If you really want out of the rat trap, out of the story, you've got to spend the time going within sincerely. And it doesn't take a billion books, and it doesn't take 18 different meditation mantras and chants and mudras and incense to get there. It's just a simple matter of going within and being quiet and asking, who am I? It is the most critical question anybody can ever ask. That is the question took me 20 or 5 years to get an answer to. But that was the main question I asked.
Would you say it's fair to say that if you go into yourself asking the question, invoking a response from Creator God, whatever it is, your own self, universe, whatever term that makes you feel happy, warm, and fuzzy is fine with me.
Yeah.
But when you go inside with intention to tickle the universe, hoping to receive an answer to the question of who am I, isn't that part of the trap as well, expecting a response? Because in your supplication of asking who am I, you begin to integrate energies over time. And you may have a realization or an epiphany, but would you say or support the idea to not go in there expecting an aha, because that limits your expansion process?
There's a difference between expecting an answer and asking the question. If you simply look within and wanting to sincerely know who you really are, then the answer will eventually come. It just takes sincerity and quiet and time and persistence. That's all it takes.
Yeah. I'm really big on passion and sincerity, because passion would be the active or the fire, and sincerity would be the soft or the passive. And those two together, when you put those two together, mountains will move. I've seen it. I still see it in my own life.
Yeah. You got it. Absolutely, Keith. And so then the third thing that I recommend, that time within, you ask that question, who am I? You get really clear on the structure of the ego, where it comes from, how it thinks, what the story is, how it's shaped and perpetuated. And then the third thing you do, and this runs throughout the course of my book and what my book is really about, is there are exercises you can do, and I can talk about one right now, that are very, very simple, but that help you gain awareness, a different perspective, not of the isolation that the senses give us that, you know, would tell me is like, you're over there, Keith, and I'm over here, but exercises that change our perception so that we can begin to see the blanket that connects us, you know, the quantum field that connects us. For example, when I'm walking out in the woods, or if I'm in my house, it doesn't matter, if I'm at the grocery store, I will, you know, an eagle will fly overhead. There are lots of them out here. It's so beautiful. And I will acknowledge the eagle, and I will go, wow, you are so beautiful. And then in the next breath, I will recognize and remember, oh my God, that is truly me. That's another peek in that blanket. That's another piece of consciousness that is me. And yes. So after that, I acknowledge it. Oh, I am so beautiful. I do that to a tree. You are so beautiful. And I drink it in, and I contemplate my connection with that tree, and I acknowledge I am so beautiful. I do it with people when I meet them. You know, I don't say it to their face. They'd think I was crazy. But after I've met somebody and they walk away, I remind myself, by me. It was so nice to meet me in another form, in another expression. So that's one exercise people can do. Another real quick one is actually a martial arts technique called soft eyes. I don't know if you're familiar with this, but basically martial arts practitioners do this so that they're not fixing their gaze on an opponent.
They're scanning.
Because if they let the room in, they don't fix their gaze. They let their gaze soften so that the energy and the information, visual information, can come in almost 360 degrees into their brain. Yes.
And you know, so, I use that technique when I'm out of my body. Is there really out of body? We're just using words. When I have dreamscape experiences and I'm out there, instead of going, oh my God, there's a message on the table for me. I need to remember that so I can wake up and have a spiritual message for when I wake up. I don't. I use the word scan, but I don't have a fixed focus. I have no intention really except to absorb through what I would call my eyes. Absolutely. I totally get that.
So you can take that martial art technique of soft eyes and, you know, you sit in front of your desk and look at your computer keyboard and let your eyes go soft and just let the information in the room and the vision of the keyboard in. And without fixing your gaze on it, just contemplate that there is a quantum sea of information that is exactly, the keyboard is you at a very essential level. There is no boundary. There are no borders. There are no borders to anything. That's the appearance of that peak in the blanket. So taking soft eyes when you walk, do anything like that, and just let the world in and let the energy resonate, and you begin to experience the world differently and put yourself in it as part of it, rather than this sense of separate self that we have from the moment we get spit out of the birth canal. That message of I am physical and I am separate. So these are a few little techniques that we can use to start softening the boundaries of what we call the self, blurring the edges so that we become aware of our essential unity with everything and everyone.
I love that you had mentioned about beauty. For me, that's a very, very big thing for me, is looking at things as beautiful, because like you said, it softens the edges. Everything begins to seamlessly begin to blend together. There's a glow. You can see a glow. You can see a hue that surround all things. And something else you mentioned, I've mentioned this many times on this show, which is you had mentioned that when you see someone out in public and you find something about this person and you loved it, and when they walk away, you said, oh, that's the beautiful aspect of me. Well, I often still do this practice when I am in public. I'll find someone or I'll meet someone. As I'm shaking their hand, I may notice the awareness of their grip, a cologne, the dialect that they may have as they speak, a pendant around their neck, physical beauty. Whatever it is, I begin to massage about this person that I find as beautiful, and I begin to salivate, and I begin to hyperfix and hyperfocus on this person's quality that is calling to me as an aspect of beauty. And I have seen this repeatedly, Cate, that God will walk right out of that person in front of my face, because I have found such a space of centeredness, and they don't even know, they don't begin to know what's happening. They know something's happening. But it's the same idea. When I begin to find that within me, it begins to call itself forth up and through other people. But also on the flip, when I see something and I acknowledge, it brings it up in me. And it helps the integration process of one becoming more and more aware, expanded awareness. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. That's beautiful. And
it's a fun technique. If anyone would try it, just find someone that you just meet, especially, and find something about them that you really, really think is just really cool and juicy, and hyperfix yourself on it. Well, don't be caught, but just find that place in you that really, really digs that attribute about that person, and watch how the dialogue goes.
Nothing like complimenting something and yeah. somebody from a very genuine space. Everything to bridge the perceptual gap that we have living in physical bodies. This whole thing about the illusion that, you know, we're just in a dream and all of this is an illusion and it's not real. And it's so funny because I've come to such a completely different understanding about that. It's like, it's not that human life and existence isn't real. It's that our separation and our understanding about our individual separation and our individual expression, that's what's not real. You know, if you walked in the room and, you know, stuck out your hand and shook my hand, I would feel it. If you slapped me in the face, it would hurt. You know, if I stubbed my toe or barked my shins, ow, you know, don't tell me this isn't real. And our separation, the way we look and the way we perceive, and then the way we feel isolated and vulnerable and frightened, that is what's not real. We're acting from our illusions and our story that tell us we are separate and alone, that you're Cate and you're Keith and never the twain yeah. shall meet. And that is the only illusion. That's the dream.
And people often think that when they're afraid, that it creates a wedge or a buffer between that and which they are claiming they are afraid of. But what they don't realize is that in the fear, it throws them directly in the path of that harm's way. I understand the fight or flight idea that yeah. sometimes fear has this guiding mechanism that says, hey, you're about to be in serious trouble. I understand that aspect of it. But I'm talking about the fear that's self-induced out of ignorance, or someone's just habitually afraid about a situation and they don't realize reoccurringly they putting themselves in said situation that they wish they hadn't through the fear that they are choosing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And over I keep being reminded, actually, as I was coming into consciousness this morning from my sleep state, it was actually one of the first messages I received again was this. And it was actually very interesting. It was like, if for a moment I perceived the whole idea about Satan, the devil, is that movement into separation, into that belief that I am separate and that there is something outside of me that could hurt me. The moment we have separation, Keith, we absolutely naturally have fear. Because there's something other, and we are vulnerable, and we feel it. We can be wounded physically, emotionally, mentally. We know that. So that, oh, Satan. Wow. I mean, that just kind of like blew my socks off. I was like, wow, that's what Satan is the belief in that movement into movement into separation, where all of a sudden there's some other out there. And that's what we fear, is that other. And there is no other. I forget where the quote was. Is somebody asked Rama Maharshi or Maharshi? I have no idea who the dude was that was asked this. You know, well, what do we do about this? You know, the political upheaval and this, you know, division between others. And his answer was, there is no other. That's what we have to realize. And that was, and the end result, Keith, that was why I know I was pushed to write the book, The E-Word, is because we have to get past this belief in the other, in self and other, and get past that story, because it's dividing us and it's driving us. You know, we've come to a place technologically in our evolution where we cannot afford that kind of illusion anymore. It's getting far too dangerous to play with children's concepts of who we think we are.
I've said in my work, The Divine Principle, that I've written years ago, which is, if we don't move through our troubles individually and collectively, we are at a space right now, a place right now, that the energy is lifting to such a degree that if you don't move yourself through your troubles, your illusions, or your issues, these things are going to blow up bigger, faster, in ways that you cannot possibly balance it. And then you realize that life on Earth is just too difficult. On some level, you don't understand. You may check yourself off of this planet.
Yeah, well, everything snowballs. I mean, that's called entropy.
Right.
So, or karma, whichever word you prefer.
Yeah, we are coming to the top of the hour. Would you give out your contact information, Cate? And please leave us with a final thought, hopefully something that our listening audience can use and put forth in their daily life so they can see some change if that's what they're desiring.
They can reach me at catemontana.com. That's Cate with a C. And the book's on Amazon and anywhere else. Let me see. Wow, one final amazing piece of advice. There's no pressure there. Now's the time. You know, now is the time, like never before, where we can no longer afford to be spiritually asleep and accepting the same old, the platitudes. We cannot continue the story of our spirituality. It's time to embody. It's time to take the time and pull ourselves out of the hypnosis of the electronic and the franticness of the world and to go within and to command the truth to come forward through our into our beings to make itself known. Now is the time to do that. We can't play the games. We can't play the stories anymore, not even the spirituality story.
Cate Montana, thank you for being a wonderful guest on Sooner of Light Radio. You're appreciated. I love your zest. I love your pop. Keep it up.
Thank you. Thank you, Keith. Take care.
Take care, dear. Everyone, Cate Montana. I love her zest. I love her passion, and I love her fire. I can hear it in the voice. She's very lively. It reminds me of me, my beautiful self. Next week, listen to this, listening audience. I have another juicy tidbit for you, another juicy guest. Next week on Center of Light Radio, my guest is Alex Teplish, and we will be speaking about, in the beginning, the epic of the Anunnaki. This guy has a most phenomenal trailer for his book. You can find me at Keith Anthony Blanchard on Facebook. Just connect with me just to be my friend. I love this kind of stuff. But also, if you have not yet, go to YouTube and look up Center of Light Radio channel. And there you will find all past archives of my shows. You can also go to Inception Radio Network. Inception Radio Network has tons and tons of shows, phenomenal quality content. I want to say thank you to Joe, MJ, and Bob.